And welcome to Rock, Paper, Swords, the historical action and adventure podcast. My name is Matthew Harfy.
And my name is Stephen A. McKay.
And we're both best-selling historical fiction authors, and together we chat about all things historical and anything that could fall under the banner of action and adventure in books, film, TV and games.
Oh, and we also talk about rock music like Black Sabbath from time to time.
Our guest today is Paul Finch. Paul Finch is an English author and scriptwriter. He has a diverse and very successful career, from the popular TV programme The Bill to horror and fantasy stories and films, Doctor Who spin-off stories, and the very successful gritty crime series of DS Mark Heck Heckenberg novels. Paul's latest pivot has been to move into the historical fiction genre, writing under the name P.W. Finch. USURPER, set in the cataclysmic year of 1066, was published earlier this year. Welcome to Rock, Paper, Swords, Paul.
Thanks very much. I'm really grateful to be asked to be here.
That's good to have you here, Paul. We both read and endorsed your book, so...
Oh, right. Of course. Yeah. That's,
I think that's actually generous. The first time we've had a guest on that we've both endorsed our book, so that's quite a first. Oh, right. First for the podcast.
Yeah, first time for everything, isn't it?
I mean, it's great. I'm still waiting for the check, though. You said you'd send me that £5.
That's a shame. I've already got mine.
Yeah.
I know.
Well, I'm a bit cheap. I can only pay one of you.
Okay, fair enough. I think we misunderstood that. We thought the £5 was £5 each. Or £5 for the two of us. Bloody hell. You really are cheap.
So you've had a successful career, very successful writing crime and fantasy stroke horror. So why the move into historical fiction and why 1066?
Well, to be honest with you, the USURPER, I mean, my earliest interests, long before I started writing crime fiction, I kind of always loved, you know, sword and shield heroics from being a little kid, from my dad telling me the stories of the Greek legend, Greek heroes and Beowulf and anything that involved, you know, heroes tackling evil with a sword, a shield or a battle axe or whatever. Read Conan as a kid and Lord of the Rings and all these kind of things. I did history university and A-level, and I really enjoyed medieval and ancient history. So because I went into the police, it seemed an obvious thing to do when I was a copper to write crime fiction. You know, it's what I knew and what I had a lot of success with. I'd always had half an eye on historical fiction. You're right to call it a pivot, because it would have been an absolutely enormous pivot if it hadn't been for unusual circumstances, those unusual circumstances being COVID. When we all got locked down for a year, you probably experienced it yourself. The publishing industry kind of went into slow motion, didn't it, a little bit? That certainly did for me. And I sort of delivered everything I was supposed to deliver, I was contracted to deliver, and then was waiting months for responses because there were just nobody in the offices in London or whatever the reason was. And I literally had time to kill, so I sort of started speculatively writing a book that I'd wanted to write for quite a while. It was an adventure set on the eve of the Norman Conquest, which is, as you mentioned, a cataclysmic date in English and probably British history as well. And I'd written 40,000 words before life seemed to sort of start returning to normal. And I thought, well, I'll just send it to my agent to see what she thinks. And she really liked it. She said, I think I could probably sell this. She said, but obviously you're not known as a historical author, so you're probably going to have to write the rest of the book. I thought, well, I'm halfway there anyway now, so I might as well. So I did. And yeah, it got picked up. And obviously they made me change my name but they wanted to keep the Finch because it had a sort of vague brand recognition. And the rest is history, if you don't pardon the pun. I mean, it's an ongoing process. I mean, there's a sequel already written, and I've been commissioned to write a couple more. So it's hopefully a new string to my bow. I mean, I've not stopped writing crime fiction, but this, I think, is definitely a new avenue I'm going to explore a lot more, as long as people will be happy to read me.
What do you think about the writing under a pseudonym, even though it's the same surname but slightly different name? Do you think it makes a difference? Do you think it's a good idea?
I have to be led by the publishers on this. I mean, I have no experience of writing historical fiction professionally before. I mean, you never. I don't know about you guys, but I've always had the opinion that how am I ever going to build a career for myself if I have to change my name every so often?
Yeah,
absolutely.
But I think I'm long enough in the tooth now to not care whether people know it's me or not, as long as I've got a, you know, as long as I'm doing the thing I love and getting paid for it.
Well, I suppose in your situation now that you've got the career behind you, as you say, and you've got a you know, body of work, and there's people reading your crime books and your fantasy books and other books that you've written, I suppose it's less of a fear that, I mean, if the historical fiction book had just dropped and disappeared, you know, not sold very well at all, I suppose you could sort of shrug and go, okay, well, you know, carry on.
Yeah, I mean, we had a go and it didn't work.
Yeah.
We just move on. But I mean, it seems to have picked up enough traction for me to want to keep going and for my publishers to want to keep going. So,
right.
It is odd. I mean, I must admit, it does feel a bit strange because when I first started writing professionally, I was writing sort of horror and science fiction fantasy. I was writing for Doctor Who and things like that. And then I sort of moved solidly into crime. And so for sort of 10 years, it was nothing but crime stroke thriller fiction. And you get completely absorbed in that, you know. And then when it actually came to writing historical fiction, it was a bit of a wind change, you know, a bit of a direction change. I didn't feel it. It was like, it felt like a different job initially, you know.
Mm.
I mean, I'm doing them both at the same time now. I mean, I'm chasing parallel courses, but it's what we do, isn't it? You know, we have to adapt to what people want to read.
That's really interesting. How did you find that transition from, you said it felt like a different job, but I mean, in terms of research and all things like that, how difficult did you find that transition?
Well, I mean, I'm a keen researcher. I'm not one of these who believes that you have to get every single fact right, because I always think, don't let the facts get in the way of a good story. I mean, obviously, you can't roll off onto flights of complete fantasy, particularly in this field, because people will put you up. But when I was writing crime thrillers, because I was an ex-copper, I more or less didn't have to do any research at all. However, that has changed over the years because obviously police protocols change and police procedures and the law changes and all sorts of things change. So I was ended up doing loads of research for crime thrillers. So it was not particularly new. I mean, the interesting thing is, you know, if you're researching the details of a Norman conquest, it's kind of more fun than researching legal stuff online.
Yeah.
You know, legal stuff will always be dry, heavy, and also there's always a danger that you might appear on some police database because you keep querying certain aspects of police procedure and firearms procedure and all this kind of thing. No one's going to worry too much if you're investigating the Norman military system.
Yeah, although I find myself searching for, you know, how long it takes someone to bleed out after a bullet to the stomach or things like that, you know, and you sort of think, you wonder how many databases we're on, you know, for the different searches.
Well, I always find that the new thing I'm finding that is something I never really encountered when I was studying history, you know, when I was supposedly studying the real thing, was that how many, particularly when you go back more than a few hundred years, as you guys know that are very well aware, there are different versions of events, exactly what happened at this at such and such a point. Historians have different opinions about what, you know, and so I kind of go, I always find myself going with the one that suits the story best, really.
Yeah, you have
to. Or make something up, you know, if it makes something up if it's vague.
Yeah. You mentioned that you were a policeman, and I was wondering if your experiences as a policeman play into your historical writing, like. Well, I mean, as like how, say, men in authority behave, the guys in charge.
Yeah, I think so.
Yeah, or how the people they're in charge of kind of look up to them and behave towards them.
I think so. I mean, I can't speak for the police world now, but when I was in, it was very much like the military. I mean, my first shift, I would think I was the only non-ex-military guy on it. And it was very disciplined then. It was a violent world, you know, it was a lot of sort of street hooliganism in Salford in Manchester where I worked, and public order situations, and you did literally go in with a line of shields and nightsticks and a visor.
So you did probably, that? Yeah.
Yeah, yeah. It was probably as close to the experience of a Roman
shield wall.
marching against the barbarian horde as you get in modern times. So I did all that, yeah. I mean, so you get the comradeship is a key thing. But the men in authority, particularly men in authority who you don't consider to be up to the job, that's something, but obviously you have to bite your lip. So that's stuff I've kind of worked into my, I mean, I always thought there was something on the base of about perhaps one in every 10 were people who I thought deserved to be leading other, you know, other men in difficult situations. I thought the rest of my careerists or people who found their way in by luck. I guess that's probably a fair strike rate for the in terms of comparison with the, you know, the medieval world.
Yeah.
But so it gave me a little bit, but yeah, also the rough and tumble factor, you know, because it was a different police then from now. It was a lot. We were a lot less hands off, a lot more hands on then. And so there was
what period are we talking about? The eighties.
I was about my period in the police straddled the introduction of the Police and Criminal Evidence Act, which was made police procedures a lot more accountable. So the days of, you know, having a quiet word with people in back streets and then send them on their way were gone. Everything was put on paper and everything was photographed and recorded and, oh, you know, within reason.
No, I think, and also the thinking of the sort of physical confrontation of being in a shield wall effectively, mm-hmm. and people shouting and throwing things at you and you're trying to hit
fear
you.
Fear and everything, yeah.
Yeah, and just...
Well, yeah, the funny thing was, because you had fireproof body armour on, and you had a big, and it was literally like a Roman shield. It was like from your, you know, from your mid-shin to the peak of your helmet.
Yeah.
And heavy perspex shield. The worst thing was they were very heavy to keep raised, but they'd be hit with everything from bricks to Molotov cocktails to hammers and knives and acid and all this kind of thing. So it probably was a fairly similar experience. Of course, no one got killed. Usually by the time you got to their line, they all ran off.
Yeah.
So, you know, or the barricade, they all ran off. So,
I guess that's the main difference. If you had like another police force at the other end of the street,
the same gear,
sparing off with you, the same gear, then it would be
hammering each other with functions and all sorts. Yeah. No, thankfully that didn't happen.
that would be interesting. Yeah, but that's kind of, I suppose that's the only way you'd get to live the reality. But it's interesting because, I mean, there can't be very many people, apart from, you know, policemen, like you say, or people doing reenactment that are actually, you know, actually use shields in any sort of fighting situation.
Right.
Yeah.
I mean, we did, that is true probably, although we had a lot of experience in the Northwest. Manchester and Liverpool were always burning in the 80s. We got sent down to Wolverhampton a couple of times when it was bad there, but we did our public order training with the RUC, as they were called at the time. And our experience was nothing compared to their experience. I mean, they would come under gunfire. But we never had that, but they did. You know, so talking to some of their lads when we were training them, I mean, that was another step up, you know. That really was a war situation that they were in. So there's always a worse scenario.
Somebody worse off than you.
Exactly.
So changing the subject drastically from shield walls,
right?
But something else that we talk about on the podcast quite a bit is rock music, of course. And I from social media that you're a big rock and metal fan, and you post every Friday, I think it is, you post a track on social
metal
media.
Metal morning.
Great.
Sometimes I get a load of feedback. Sometimes I don't get any, and I don't know whether it's just because it's a band that's not very well known, or it's just the fact of it's just bad luck. There's nobody around who wants to comment. You know,
every now and again I see, because it's funny, because the way that social media works, of course, I don't see every one of the things of that course. You post, but every now and again I see one pop up, and sometimes I've responded, or sometimes it makes me think, oh, I'll go and check out another song. You know, it reminds me of something else, and I'll check and post something. But but on that note, that you love rock music and metal music, I did see, at some point in the not too far distant past, you met Tony Iommi signing. And, you know, what an honor. So first, you know, how was that? What was all that about? And did you get to go and have a beer and a chat with him? And secondly, can you get him to come on the show?
Well, the answer to the last question is who knows? I'll try and elaborate a little bit without too long-winded. So what happened was that one of my crime novels, quite a few years ago now, I'm not sure which one it was. I think it was called either Strangers or Shadows. It opened in the Brass House pub in the middle of Birmingham. Now, I don't know if you're familiar with Birmingham. The Brass House is an absolutely cracking pub, very music oriented. And it has the sort of every summer the Birmingham Jazz Festival is held there. And I, because I'd set the opening scenes in the book in the Brass House, they asked me to go down and open the Jazz Festival. And I've been doing it ever since.
So amazing.
I know. I mean, my books have nothing to do with jazz, you know. but we got very friendly with the organisers. And what had happened was I had in a chat once in the pub with a few of the guys down there, I had mentioned that one thing I know, because I'm a keen art collector, you know, fine art. And I was very interested. I've always wanted. I'd love a real artist. I'm not talking illustrator or someone who does book covers. I'm not denigrating their talent, but I mean, the sort of person who does oil paintings to do an interpretation of one of my novels. And I didn't realise that one of the guys there was a guy called Mike Holley, who's the manager of the West Side Bin in Birmingham. She's all about attracting investment into improving the cultural life of a part of central Birmingham that was pretty run down. And Mike arranged a competition. Well, my last crime novel, Never Seen Again, a bunch of local artists to read it and do an interpretation. And I went, that was such an honour, you know. And I went down and I judged the three finalists. And it was a big event. It was in the Velvet Rooms in Birmingham. Then there was a big book signing and Tony turned up. Now, Tony's a friend of my colleague, so I think Mike had asked him to go along. And what a nice fella. I mean, then my wife, Kath, was chatting away to Tony's wife, you know. And it was funny, really, because I sort of said to Tony, this was quite, he's a very witty guy. I said, Kath said to me, tell Tony when the last time you saw him was. And I said, well, to be honest, Tony, I said, the last time I actually saw you in the flesh was at the Manchester Free Trade Hall on the Never Say Die tour. And I said, I was about 14 then.
A while ago.
And I said, look, I must admit, I was only a young lad. And he said, so was I. He was a bit old. But the thing is that, you know, Tony is around that scene a lot. And I'm hopeful I can meet him again. And, you know, if you want me to put a word in, I will. But I don't know. I have no control over his
accent. No, absolutely. Well, no, it'd be brilliant.
We've had his former band member, Ian Anderson, on from Jethro Tull.
From Tull, yeah. Oh, funny enough, he mentioned when he was with Tull. I had no idea he'd been with Tull. And he mentioned Tull when we were chatting because I said, you're the first rock personage I've come face to face to, apart from Mick Jagger, who I almost walked into in Waterstones in Camden Town when I was waiting for a meeting with my agent. And you know what it's like. You see, you're so familiar with these people, you kind of almost think you know them. And I saw Mick Jagger coming towards me. And I almost sort of said, hey, Mick, you know. He probably gets that all the time. I didn't. I just managed to get control of myself. And then Tony said that I didn't realise he'd met Mick Jagger when he was on the Rolling Stones Rock and Roll Circus with I had no idea he'd been with Jethro Tull. I mean, I'm a big Tull fan, but I didn't know Tony had played.
But it was only for a very, very short
time. Yeah, it was short, 2 weeks or something.
Yeah, he said it was a very short time, yeah.
Yeah,
way back, wasn't it? That was the late 60s.
Very early.
Yeah. I think he had it was a bit of a crossroads and he had to decide whether to stick with Tull or go back to Black Sabbath, wasn't it?
Yeah, I didn't get a chance to discuss it with him really, because to be honest with you, when I was actually face to face and signing a book for him, I'm a bit tongue-tied really, you know.
What I say
is how much you love the music and how much you've been a fan all those years, you know.
Yeah. But is he a reader of your books then? Yeah.
Yeah, apparently so. Yeah.
Right.
Which was so nice. And the funny thing was that, you know, I think I did a blog post that when I got home, and they'd obviously put the word out in the various rock and metal websites because I had thousands of hits that day. I usually get a couple of hundred at the most, you know. But suddenly there was like 8,000 hits, you know. So. Yeah. How many books I might have sold, I don't know. I mean, I actually wished it was one of the darker ones because it was a more procedural-based crime thriller rather than one of the Heck ones, which are full of serial killers and psychotic cults and all this kind of thing, you know. It was a great honour to meet him. Yeah.
That's brilliant.
Hey, maybe listen.
I know what you mean about being tongue-tied, though, because when we had Ian Anderson on, it was the It was a real honour. Yeah. We were quite nervous beforehand, but you kind of just have to...
He comes over as a very articulate, intelligent and likeable guy, though, doesn't he? You know,
well, so. Yeah, it was very nice to us, but I think one of the reasons Tony actually didn't stay in Jethro Tull was because he didn't like how Ian did things. Ian would be sitting off on his own. The rest of the band were in a cafe, and Tony was like, "What's going on here? I don't like this camaraderie. He's not really here." So,
I've only ever seen him interviewed. So,
but you're right. He is very articulate and clever, but I think he doesn't kind of suffer fools gladly. And we're worried we'd waste his time, and he'd kind of go off at us. But I mean, it was great. It was great.
And we both done a lot of. I mean, I like Jethro Tull, and it's Stephen's favorite band, so we'd done a lot of prep. We were ginned up and had all everything ready and no messing. And he warmed up and you know we didn't know he was going to talk to us for very long. We thought you'd sort of been prepared from the PR people said he might only talk to you 20 minutes, you know, but he ended up speaking for like well over an hour.
Mm-hmm.
And he was happy to carry on. So you think okay.
We have a lot of stories to tell, I imagine.
Absolutely, yeah.
It was great. Well we better get back to writing. So you've written for TV, film, audio, magazines, and novels, of course. So which type of writing do you enjoy the most, and what are some of the biggest challenges writing for these different types of media?
Well, I think my best experiences have been writing for writing novels. I guess like anything, you've got to land, you've got to get an editor you like, you've got to be really, really. Keen on what it is you're writing, you know. I mean, I say that because one way into television used to be writing soap operas, you know. You'd be writing scripts for stories that weren't yours. At least with a novel, you know. That's not the whole story. I mean, with the bill, I had to hit them with the premise that they were prepared to commission, and so it was they were my ideas. I enjoyed the bill, but it was a long running saga, and I don't want to be there forever. Novel writing for me is the thing, the extra freedom, the extra space. And in my experience, at least, it's just you and your editor. You know, you write a film script. I mean, I've written a couple of horror films which have gone to the cinema, small ones. I've written many, many others that haven't.
Mm-hmm.
And it just seems to be you're serving so many different masters all the time. Every time a new person comes on board, it starts with you and the producer, then you'll have a script, then they'll have to write the script, then you have a script editor who's going to help you get it into shape, then if you're lucky you'll get to the stage where the director comes along, because he or she will want the whole thing completely rewritten. Then you'll have a sales agent, oh, we can't sell this, we have to change the whole thing. Then the money people come in. I mean, if you get to this stage you're really lucky. But it gets harder because the money people don't know anything about films, but they feel they have to say or do something because they're paying for it. So you basically have to change the whole damn thing again. Then you might get a co-writer, and by that time you've lost the will to live. I mean, you occasionally get my best experience writing a film script was The Devil's Rock, because I once worked with the director that actually got made. It's funny that actually what we were saying earlier on. Someone asked me in the pub locally, "What's your new film called?" And I said, "Oh, it's called The Devil's Rock." I said, "Oh, is it about metal?" it's actually a World War II horror movie. It's nothing to do with metal, but I worked solidly with the director and nobody else. So, and that was made, and it did reasonably well.
You keep the vision much tighter, I imagine. I mean, just the two of you. I mean,
of course, yeah. You know, I mean, I don't know what your guys' experience is with. I mean, I've found that writing. Since I became a novelist, you know, very grand term, since I became a novelist, it's just me and the editor, mm-hmm. you know, and maybe and a copy editor who you can either agree with or disagree with. So I found that a much smoother. I mean, you don't always agree with them, do you? You don't always agree with your editor. I try to be compliant. You know, I'm not one of these guys who digs my heels in all the time. And I find it a much smoother process, you know. But with film and TV, I think the problems with TV writing, for example, now, particularly if you're like British television, since it's open to the whole world now, since it's all streaming, and it's not just the competition is phenomenal. Mm-hmm. You know, the writers, you're competing against writers from all over the world. And of course, a lot of broadcasters have their pet writers already, you know. So you really, really, and you have to do an awful lot of work before you get any money. And I don't want to read it, but that's what we're in it for, isn't it? It's our jobs.
That's true. And I think, I mean, I've only sort of scratched the surface of the TV world, and we never actually really got into it. You know, I was on the edge trying to get in with The Serpent Sword, and we wrote, you know, Greg Stewart, a guy, wrote the scripts, and I worked with him on the Bible and a bit on the scripts and stuff, and we worked on the TV series Bible and things, and you know, we had some interviews and with different producers and things, but it's I was just actually talking to someone earlier today about it and saying how much they expect you in the industry now. I don't know if it was like this always, but to do a lot of free work, so you're doing a ton of work for free. Well, with the possibility that maybe, you know, but maybe Monday it might get made.
Yeah, I mean, you know, in my experience, I mean, most of the producers I've worked with are basically haven't got any money. You know, they can't raise the production, even the development money, until they've got a script. So it used to be that you got paid a decent advance to write a script. And then you got to a situation where deals were, you know, being back-ended. So you wouldn't even get paid on principal photography anymore. You might get paid further down the line. I get a bit fed up with it because they're not doing that with the cameramen, are they? You know.
No, well, it was even like that. I mean, it was like that with us. I mean, it was a very small production company. We were just trying to sort of raise the funds, talking to people, you know, to get a bigger producer involved. But even in terms of, we got an agent in the States and set us up with some meetings and things. So we put together a really slick presentation deck, because this was all over Zoom and everything and sharing slides, and it was really good looking. Yeah. And the agent then was like, oh, change this and change that and change, you know, and every time it was like huge amount of work to change all of this slide deck, which you just think like the amount of hours put in.
Well, when you've done
to
it,
do
when
stuff
you've...
which in the end doesn't amount to anything because nothing comes of it.
Well, know? I mean, I've worked on scripts that I've had 20 drafts on.
Yeah, it's crazy. And if you're getting paid for each draft separately, which you should do, really.
Oh, well, I mean, but the statement's read that you're not. And I get the feeling sometimes, because the producers are struggling to raise the funds, that they just feel like they need to keep you working, like you haven't got other work to do.
Yeah.
And my view with regard to, so I mean, if someone wanted to make a film or TV show of any of my stuff now, and, you know, lots of stuff's been optioned. I mean, I've had 300 short stories and novellas published since the early 90s in America and here. And if anyone wanted, so they're all out there. And I've quite a few of them have been optioned, but, you know, the options have expired. If anyone wants to make one, my view is always, well, I might, you know, if it's essential to move the project on, I will do a draft of the script. But after that, you're going to have to get somebody else, you know, because I've got other things to do. And, you know, you're earning some money, don't you? Again, I keep saying,
I think that's the safe way to do it. I think like Bernard Cornwell with his series now, The Last Kingdom, obviously recently, and Sharp before that. I think he likes to be involved in as much as he likes to get an invite to go and visit the set or something. But I don't think he gets involved in the writing or anything. You know, once the thing's optioned, he just steps away and lets them do what they need to do.
The thing is as well, you know, that it is a skill writing for film and TV. And it's not just because you can write a good book, good novel, it doesn't mean you... It's an easy adjustment to write. I mean, there are people who do it all the time professionally. It might be better if they, you know. So you as long as I always say, as long as it's from a novel by Paul Finch, you know, as long as I get paid and I've got a credit, you know, I can't complain too much. Yeah.
Yeah, but I mean, so you're saying about getting paid, but at the end of the day, if you're a full-time author, you need to get paid. So you're quite right to focus on that. And it's nice to say, well, I'm an artist and that's all that matters. But it's not, is it? You've got to keep a roof over your head. So you definitely want paid.
Yeah, I mean, you know, it's I've got a wife and kids, you know. I mean, it's it's got to be done. So
I think the TV industry seems to thrive on this kind of idea that people are so desperate to get in that they'll just work for free until, you know, on the off chance that maybe it will happen.
I think at one time it was, you know, not quite like that. I mean, at one time, network, what we now call network TV, you know, like the sort of big three, ITV, well, there were big two, weren't they? ITV and BBC, you know, produced loads and loads and loads of original drama and comedy. And there was a lot of work for a relatively small pool of professional writers. You know, they had good careers. I mean, there are still people who make a fortune from it. There's no doubt about that. But
I
do think there's an element of you need to get your foot very firmly in the door. It's quite hard to get through the door. Certainly when you get to my stage of life, You know, I mean, I was in and then I came out again. I don't think I'm bothered. I'm not too bothered about knocking on that door again. I just want to write novels.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, fair enough. Yeah. So talking about the writing novels, which is firmly where you are now, what's a typical writing day like for you?
Well, I have a slightly eccentric process. I'm told it's eccentric. I always dictate my first draft onto a dictaphone, usually when I'm walking the dogs.
Yeah.
So I get exercise and they get exercise. I then come home and I type it up. I don't have an app that types it up, because what you've really got is gobbledygook. It's a broken, it's thought processes, it's streams of consciousness.
Yeah.
It's just in roughly, I get everything in roughly, and then I just get it down. Just get it down, chapter by chapter. On my second draft, that's where I consider I'm really writing. That's when I'm actually really turning it into something.
How long does that first part of the process take you? That sort of getting, ideas.
I tend not to do the whole book that way. It tends to be sort of chapter by chapter. It can be a day per chapter sometimes. Obviously, some chapters are slightly more complex to write than others. I mean, I love doing battle scenes, but I always think you've got to be tight when you do a battle scene. You know, it's got to be, it's got to hit the right note, hasn't it? I don't think you can just do that way. Overall, it takes me, I think I can usually write a novel. A first draft is done. I'm on well into the second draft after about 3 months, probably. I can do it quicker than that if I need to. But the second draft is the bit where I enjoy. I have a lot of playlists, I've got mood music for what, depending on what I'm. So with USURPER, which was the 1066 novel, I've got a playlist of sort of medieval music and film music that plays away in the background while I'm masterfully turning all this gibberish into a lovely piece.
We've got a question about that, but we'll save that to the end.
Okay.
So on the writing then, so how many drafts do you do before you consider it ready to send to your agent or editor?
I guess, I do the first draft I've just mentioned, that's the dictation draft. The second draft is when I really try and turn it into something nice. Then I do a read-through draft to myself, and then the last draft is a read-through with my wife, Catherine, who's my harshest critic. Doesn't let much get past her. So I guess you're looking at three to four drafts, really. I mean, the last one is just a read-through. It's a proofread.
Mm-hmm.
Then, of course, your editor takes it away. You've got, like, another four or five drafts to go.
Absolutely, yeah.
You have to rewrite the whole thing then and all that, as you know. So
yeah. Handed in the first draft, but really it would be like the second or third draft, I guess, in your analogy there. So I've done my read through edit I just sent it off to my editor yesterday. So I'm now in that moment of waiting. I said I've got two editors really. I said in the email, I said, can you please let me know if you enjoy it? Because they have this tendency just to go silent for months on end.
I know, it's horrible.
And I sit there. I mean, it happened to me a couple of years ago. I had a meeting with. I sent the draft, and the editor had replied to me a few weeks later and said, I've got some comments, but it's nothing important. But I'll feed my comments through to you." And he didn't say nothing important. He said, "I'll feed my comments back through to you in the next week or so before Christmas." And this was like in December. I was like, "Okay." So December goes gone. No email. January goes, I'm going to meet him in February. So I meet him for lunch, like late February or something. And I said to him, "What's going on? Did you hate it?" And he said, "Oh, no, no. In the end, I decided the comments are not that important. So I just handed it straight over to the copy editor. It was fine. There was no work needed. It was fine." It was just like, what?
I mean, that is actually, that's nice to hear, but it would be nice if he told you.
Terrified. I really thought he hated it. You know?
Well, you know, we all suffer from imposter syndrome, don't we? I mean, my last novel, I think halfway through, I got a note from my editor just to say, just a quick one, I'm really, really enjoying this. I'm halfway through and it's brilliant. So that is worth its weight in gold, Mark.
If you get a little, anything really, just say, I'm enjoying it.
Yeah.
Oof, no. It just takes such a weight off your mind, because I don't think, I mean, unless you've written a novel, anyone who's listened to this has written something or created something at that magnitude, because it takes months and months of effort on your own. Yeah. I don't think it's difficult to understand the weight.
I'm always firmly of the opinion that, you know, at some point it's all going to go belly up, and that they're going to, you know, it's almost something I expect to suddenly get a call from a publisher saying, sorry, we were, you know, we meant to publish Saul Pinch, not Paul Finch, you know, and so you've just gone out of the contract null and void sort of thing. You know, I'm always expecting something like that to happen.
I'm glad it's not just me.
Yeah, I think we all do, you know.
I live in fear of the one day that, you know, you hand something in and they just say, what the F is this? You know, this is absolute rubbish. You know, who are you? We thought you could write, you know.
But the good thing is that, you know, at least you're always going to be frosty, aren't you? You're always going to be as sharp as you can be when you do the job, you know. If you,
well, yeah.
We'll betide anyone who thinks that's it, I am now the perfect article. Mm-hmm. You know, that's when it'll all go wrong, isn't it? You know?
Well, I think we've all seen that, I think, with some artists, and they get to a point, they get to a certain level, not just in writing, but I think in other walks of life, where they believe that they're like, they're nothing, they could do no wrong, and suddenly everything becomes bloated and a bit messy.
Yeah,
and,
yeah, you know. yeah.
Metallica. moving on. So you mentioned this earlier. Assume you work in more than one project at the same time?
Well, obviously I do prioritise if a deadline's coming up. I've delivered a manuscript and it's going through. I'm halfway through the third book in the historical series at the same time as working up a new crime novel. So, but the historical one is kind of taking priority now, because the next one's out in January. So I think once we get into the autumn, I think it'll be all focus will be on that one. So But sometimes things come along that you just have to deal with, don't you? You know,
you write like the historical one day and then the crime another day?
I can't do that. I feel like maybe I could do, I mean, as I say, you know, I might be happily writing away about the Middle Ages, and then perhaps there's an edit on a crime novel that's very urgent. Right. I may have to do that.
Yeah.
But it is strange, though. I have to perhaps go out for have a day off to sort of gradually adjust from one to the other.
Yeah.
Sounds a bit late, doesn't it?
But I had that when I was just, the manuscript I've just sent in was set in the 19th century, late 19th century. And the book that I've got coming out, which was just going through all the copy edits and all the proofreads and everything, is set in the 8th century, you know. So having that shift, as you suddenly, you one day you're beavering away, and the next minute it's like, okay, we've got to get these copy edits in by the end of the week. You've got to go and read through all these edits of this book that you wrote a year before and you can't really remember.
Oh, absolutely. I wouldn't try and write two books at the same time from scratch, you know, simultaneously.
No.
I don't think I could do that. I mean, I think I pride myself on writing quickly. So if something is coming up and there's imminent work required, I usually will try and get ahead, you know. I may have to break off to do something, but I'd rather just do one book at a time if I can.
Yeah.
It's easier.
I mean, sometimes I get asked to do a lot of short stories, and most of them I have to say no to, but it usually only takes me a couple of weeks to do a short story. So if it's convenient, I can break off to do a short story, you know.
So how many more of the Wolfbury Chronicles are you going to do?
Oh, well, there's one. It's a duology. There's one at the moment. It's really the second half of the story. The first one ended, I think, a couple of days after the Battle of Hastings. Obviously, there's a lot more of that story alone to tell. And Serdic has got to find his way home and recapture his father's earldom. Mm. So there's lots in that one, but that's the second book. That's already written. That's out in January. I've been asked to do by the same publisher to do a. I sent them another idea. You see, set during the Third Crusade. So rather than it be, you know, a later generation of the same family, which I was tempted,
mm-hmm.
I thought, no, I'm just gonna have a completely new character, new protagonist. And it's a completely different story, and it's set almost entirely in Syria in the 12th century. So just started writing that one. It's interesting, really, because it was around that time that I was asked to give a couple of quotes for Ben Kane's Richard the Lionheart books, which I'm pleased to see keep appearing on the hardbacks, and which is nice. But then I didn't mention that I'm writing, I'm covering the same ground at the moment myself. So,
yeah.
But, you know, great minds think alike. Huh? I keep telling myself.
Well, yeah, we've had Ben on here as well. That's,
yeah.
We do all cover much the same ground in historical fiction, don't we? That's
we do, because inevitable. Me,
yeah,
he's writing the Viking stuff now, isn't he?
Exactly.
So we're all covering the same ground end.
For people who specialise in Viking stories, I mean, it's the last probably 8 or 9 years, an absolute plethora of Viking stuff on television, on the cinema, hasn't there?
Yeah, exactly.
But up until then, there'd barely been anything since Kirk Douglas. You know, it's, I mean, I know they had the odd one.
Yeah, we spoke
Michael York.
We had Giles Christian on as well, who's was a Viking author, and that was one of the questions we had for him. How did it feel to go from kind of like you say, nobody doing it, and then he did it, and then all of a sudden everybody was doing it? So kind of, I think it would be quite annoying if you were the kind of main man at one point, and then all these other people suddenly appeared like me and Matthew. And
I think the rising tide, lifts all ships. I think to some extent. I think if you get more and more visibility on that time period, it's like all the Tudor stuff, the number of writers that have made a living out of writing Tudor stuff. I mean,
there are umpteen perspectives, aren't there, to these?
Yeah, of course.
And, I mean, the Vikings is a good one, because you can look at it from the point of view of the Vikings, or you can look at the point of view of the Saxons or the Celts or the Franks, So, I mean, there's always a different way to tell a story. So I don't think we're in danger of oversaturating that market yet.
Hopefully not.
Hopefully not.
Hopefully not.
Like the Roman market, we'll move on from that to Vikings and then something else, probably.
Yeah, that will be. Yeah. Well, hopefully the next big one will be Cowboys. Late 19th century Westerns. Right. So, researching for this podcast, I found not only your own blog, which has regular blog posts from yourself. But I also found you have an unofficial website dedicated to you and run by fans.
Is that true?
Paul, have you not found it? PaulFinchAuthor.com. So it says.
I'll have to look for that.
Wow. So
I mean, I do.
So PaulFinchAuthor.com, and right. If you go on it,
okay,
it's got. Basically, it says this is run by fans, and we just love Paul Finch and everything about him. And it's got all stuff about your life and about your career.
It's me, not somebody else.
It's got photos of you in Birmingham signing your books and stuff.
Oh my
so
God.
Definitely you.
Well, I'll definitely have a look at that.
And I can't believe you didn't know about it. So I was going to ask you and say, it must be really gratifying. And I was going to say, have the creators contacted you and asked you, because it's quite an extensive website. It's not just like a one page.
Right. Well, I'll have a look. I mean, I do have. Just give me the title again. Dan,
it's Paul Finch, author.
Yeah.
.com.
Right, so that's easy enough. I mean, strange thing is, I do have a kind of cadre of quite dedicated fans who follow my crime fiction, and I get an awful lot of. I interact with them quite a lot, and the Heck books in particular seem to be very, very, very popular. So I get I'm hoping to start the series up again soon, because it went into a bit of a lull, really, when I changed publisher, but. The fans I get daily contacts from them about it. So, I mean, I recently announced I think I'd sold 1 million books. Now, I know that's not in the same league of some of our idols, but most of those are probably the Heck novels.
Right.
Sold overseas, very widely overseas as well. But I still get loads of stuff, loads of fan letters. It's really nice, I mean, I want to say letters, I mean PMs, When's it going to start again?
Yeah. It's funny. You realize when you write a popular series, I keep on feeling myself driven to write different things that are not my main series, the Benicia Chronicles, which is now 9 books.
Yeah.
And I keep sort of deviating from that, partly just to sort of diversify, but also to sort of just to do something different, not to get bored of writing. You know, I want to keep things fresh for myself. But the number of times that I get, every time I mention, oh, the latest book, I'm handing in the latest manuscript or whatever, the number of times that everyone just comments this, is that the next Beer Brand book? Is that the next Benicia Chronicles? When's that one out? It's like, oh, God, no, it's not.
it's strange, really, because, of course, there's a lot of fans talk as if we are in full control of what we write. You know, and I'd say I have to explain to them that, you know, look, my editors, my publishers have asked me to do something different, and I have to go with that, you know. Well, and someone very nice, very genuine offer, well, can we write to the publishers? And I thought, well, I mean, good luck with that.
I had that recently in Germany. Somebody said they were pissed off. This German publisher's only taken three of my books.
All right.
So there's someone's read all three. And there's still another six published already in English. And they said, hang on a minute. And so their review in German was, they said, oh, I love this series. But they said, I've now contacted the publisher and asked them. And they've said, they have no plans in publishing the rest of Matthew's books. You know, they've been really pissed off. And they sent me a long email.
I think there's a sort of misconception that we are completely in charge of everything.
Mm-hmm.
They don't realize that we're just employees like everybody else, you know.
It'd be great if the publishers did listen and suddenly they sort of took all the rest of my books in German, but you know, I don't know.
I must admit, you know, that the Heck books did sell so well and I get so much fan mail about them, but I really feel I'm going to have to get into that again somehow or other, because I do think that from a business perspective, there's a fan base there that are not being serviced.
Well, absolutely. That sounds like a no-brainer, really. Yeah.
I'm
just looking at their website, the About Us bit of your fan page, and they said, welcome to the Paul Finch unofficial website, your premier source for all things related to acclaimed author Paul Finch. We're a team of passionate readers and fans dedicated to providing comprehensive coverage of Paul Finch's work, life, and literary contributions.
Why?
There you go. Bloody and there's a whole bit about saying it's unofficial, we're not affiliated with Paul at all.
That just sounds like one of these, you know, like something off I'm Alan Partridge when he goes to some guy's house, pictures of him all over the wall, you know. I'm not saying it is. It could be.
Or I thought you were going to say something like Alan Partridge would create about himself and then deny, you know, that you created it.
Yeah, that was I was thinking. Paul's made it himself.
No, well, I must admit, I don't know anything about that, so I will have to check that out. I'd be a bit nervous, actually. I mean, what do I do if it's all factually incorrect? You know,
it doesn't look factually incorrect, but I didn't use. I sort of thought, well, I'll just stick to the other stuff. But it's interesting though, because I mean, mainly obviously it's stuff that's come from interviews and your public appearances and stuff.
Yeah.
I mean, it looks all good, and it doesn't give the impression of being weird at all. But I thought you'd know about it.
I'm not just in case any of the guys involved have said. Are listening, you know, I'm not 4 minutes suggesting it is weird. I've been caught from left field a little bit. I didn't know.
I'm sure they will be listening to this, because if they're, you know, great fans of the amazing Paul Finch, they'll be listening to this. And
well,
I'd just like to say that if they'd like to create a Stephen A. Mackay and Matthew Harvey, you know,
I'm pretty jealous about this. Yeah.
I mean, I don't know whether the level of fan interest will exist for me in the historical novels, because I don't really know the market yet. You know, I do know that within the crime thriller community, well, it does exist. You know, I'm hopeful I can get something going. It's a historical novel
crime book community readers, and that definitely seems to be a bit more like a level above anything else. Really, you know, they get right, like you see L.J. Ross's success, Mark Dawson.
You know, the Harrogate Crime Festival or Bloody Scotland or Crime Fest in Bristol. I mean, apart from this year, where Harrogate was literally washed out by torrential rain, but normally there are thousands of people there. And it's just a sea of people.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and they're all really, really, real crime fiction fans. You know, you walk through and you get accosted every 10 yards by someone asking to sign a book, which is really nice. Really gratifying.
Yeah.
I don't know whether any such thing exists within historical fiction, but
I don't think it really does. Maybe for like someone like Bernard Cornwell, it's enormous anyway, and they've got TV series and stuff. But in general, I don't think it's anything like as big as that.
No.
I mean to say, we got into the wrong genre. I need to. Well, yeah. My wife's always
even crime fiction is dwarfed by romance and children.
Yeah, my wife's always told me that if you want to make money, we should write, you know, specifically for the female audience because most readers are women. Well, and then she said, you know, crime as well. So,
well, yeah. I have to say, most of the people who contact me about my books are ladies.
Right.
Vast majority of them are, yeah. But I mean, I would imagine historical fiction probably is slightly more male.
Right? Yeah, it's more like guys like us. Yeah,
action, quite
middle aged. Yeah.
Wishing we were.
We do get quite a lot of female readers some women as well. Yeah. I think it's mainly just in general women read more than men. Mm-hmm. So yeah, if a woman, if they're into reading anyway, there's a big chance that you'll get a female readership.
I remember being told when I first started out, right at the very, very, very beginning, when I first got myself an agent, I wanted to write horror novels, and I was told in no uncertain terms, you can forget that. That's gone. And I sort of asked why, and then I was told that because horror, you know, was primarily, horror and science fiction were primarily read by men, young men,
mm-hmm.
and young men don't read anymore, they play computer games. Now, whether that dynamic has changed since then, because I'm going back 30 years, or whether it will change in the future, I don't know. I mean, I long gave up any notions of writing horror novels. And I'd grown up as a teenager reading. But it's not quite the same in America. It's a much bigger market in America, but there's very little of it over here.
That's interesting. So, well, we're coming to the end of our time together, and we always end up with the same couple of questions that we ask everybody at the end of our interviews. So the first one is, what have you been reading recently and watching recently? So what can you recommend or not, as the case may be?
Well, in terms of what I've been watching, I think I've been a casualty of the appalling Hollywood output since COVID. I mean, there's been very little, hasn't there, to be honest?
It seems to just be picking up recently. But
the strike will have a knock-on effect probably.
Yeah.
If it, you know, and it's a serious strike, so it could go on. I'm not got much to say about the cinema. I'm not a superhero fan, I'm afraid. I like the first two or three, but I think it's got a bit samey since then. I'm also not a huge enthusiastic about these. About this sort of TV, modern TV, as other people are. It's certainly glossier and more expensively made, but I'd much rather have a compact story that runs over maybe two or three seasons, that's something that and has a beginning, a middle, and an end, that's something that just goes on ad infinitum and never seems to end and changes constantly. That said, I thought Succession was one of the best things I've seen for a long time. You know, the Brian Cox drama.
Yeah. I think I tried to watch the first episode and didn't like it because everybody seemed to be horrible.
Oh, everyone is horrible. In my view, they managed to overcome that because the Machiavellian schemes are so intriguing you really don't know till the last 5 minutes who's going to win, who's going to lose. But it is a load of ruthless people stabbing each other in the back at every opportunity.
Although I started watching Yellowstone.
And
that's the same sort of thing. And it's very much sort of like, it sort of reminds me of Dallas.
Yeah.
It's a series, you know, but not that I watched it as a kid, but that sort of thing, but set in Montana, but it's all sort of backstabbing and it's very much like a soap opera, it feels like.
Yeah. But with cowboys. So in terms of what I've watched, I mean, I can't give you any real recommendations. I've seen very little recently that absolutely blew me away. I mean, funnily enough, the other week we watched a couple of the Lord of the Rings movies, and we'd also caught a couple of the Harry Potter movies. And I much prefer Lord of the Rings to Harry Potter, but I think it's both series. I thought there's just nothing comparable to that been made in years now. Mm. I did like Game of Thrones, but I thought they rushed it at the end.
Yeah.
Did you see the movie Dune that came out during Dune lockdown?
Dune I did like. I thought that was, and I look forward to the sequel, though, whether it'll be happening. By the strike, who knows? But that's one, isn't it? That's one film, you know, out of God knows how many.
I thought it's worth really watching then, because I absolutely love
Dune's amazing, Dune series.
Yeah.
Well, I think the
film is brilliant.
The book, I love the book when I read it as a teenager. And I still keep it. It's got a dedication from my late dad in the cover for me, so it's very special to me, that one. But I thought the new film, last year's film, was as close
worth
to
watching.
It could have been real. Yeah, I think so.
Yeah. Right. I reread the book just before watching the film again to reacquaint myself with it, because I hadn't read it since I was about 15 or something.
Yeah.
And
yeah.
It's a very good adaptation.
Very good. Yeah,
really
very
good.
Look out for
that. Better than that awful one in the 80s, which was
incredible. Yeah.
Yeah. but I mean, so... not many recommendations on the film or TV front, I'm afraid. Books-wise, got a very eclectic taste. I read widely across the spectrum. I read lots of horror. I read thrillers. I read science fiction. I read historical. I try to read literary fiction. Doesn't always work for me. Recent books, I would recommend. I mean, in terms of thrillers, any of Mike Craven's books are worth reading. M.W. Craven, particularly his new one, Fearless, is an absolute action fest. Don Winslow, the American author, terrific. The Force is one of the best novels of police corruption I've ever read. Also, The Cartel, again, blazing gun battles. I mean, the title speaks for itself. It's about DEA agents trying to bring down a drugs cartel in Mexico. Anything by James Lee Burke, you know, if you like your sort of deep South crime thrillers. There's a few names in terms of horror. New Kids on the Block, Josh Malerman, Stephen Graham Jones, Ronald Malfi. They're all mostly American. Again, a couple of British writers, Steve Duffy and Reggie Oliver. You'll have to look for them among the smaller presses, but they are terrific, terrific authors. Historical, all the guys we know,
yeah.
Ben, Con, Giles, yourselves. I mean, I've really, I'm just really branching out into reading stuff because there's so much. I've got so much on on a one list. I mean, that's about it, really. I've got a wall of books I've not yet read. They're all more or less, they're all more or less these animals that I've been describing to you. Was there another question?
Yeah, we've got one.
No, that's it. We've got one more question from Stephen. Yeah,
as a two-part question, I'm sure you'll like this one. What have you been listening to, and do you listen to music when you're writing?
Yeah, I definitely listen to music when I'm writing. I have a playlist for every mood. The horror. If I'm doing a horror story, it's a whole load of horror movie themes. If it's historical, I've clubbed together a massive playlist of medieval, Roman, Greek type music, with appropriate film themes. You know, I'm sure Conan's in there somewhere and things like that.
Love the Conan music. So good.
The beating drum, Basil Polidori.
Dum 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 dum. Dum.
You can't beat that. Right. Oh, I remember there was a very stirring anthem to the Beowulf film, which worked very well when I was writing Usurper anyway. But if it's the Heck books, it's rock. I'm a bit old school. You know, I grew up with Led Zeppelin and Deep Purple and Sabbath, of course, Alice Cooper, AC/DC, Montrose, Aerosmith, and I've more or less never moved on.
can you actually write listening to those tracks?
Yeah, AC/DC is.
I only do it when I'm on my second or third draft, when I'm
right, okay, I get it.
Checking through and making changes here and then. No music when I do the first draft. It's not possible to do that. Modern bands, I still like the sort of rock, the bluesy southern rock sound where it all came from. So Blackberry Smoke. I don't know if you know Joe Bonamassa.
Oh yeah.
I mean, there are others. There are others, aren't there? You know.
Have you heard Greta Van Fleet?
Greta Van Fleet.
Yeah, that's quite good.
Blackstone Cherry, of course. I did say Rival Sons. I mean, they're all.
Yeah, you mentioned.
They're very Lynyrd Skynyrd-esque. A lot of them. I'm not really a thrash or death metal or black metal fan. I like something. I like it to be a little bit more harmonious, but hard. I like a hard edge. It's got to have a hard edge.
I think our tastes are quite similar in terms of rock music. I mean, I say ours, yours and mine, Paul, because Stephen tends towards the heavier,
when I'm writing
stuff.
Yeah, but I listen to AC/DC and Van Halen and Guns N' Roses and all that all the time as well.
But I never listened to the black metal stuff.
Well, one of those, there was a black metal band with the villains that were the main antagonists in one of my Heck novels. So, right. I get as much stuff in there as I can. You know, I get as many references to the bands I like in there as I can. So, in all my books, obviously not the historical ones. So I'm kind of a very old, bit of a dinosaur. Really. I'm glad to say my son has followed in my footsteps. He's not, he's 27, he's not a kid. So he's got his own mind. He's got a much wider, broader range than me. But at the heart of it, there is, you know, proper rock.
Classic rock.
Solid rock, classic rock, yeah.
Good stuff.
Well, so that's us, isn't it?
That brings us to a conclusion. So we've been chatting for an hour, which seems about the right sort of length of time to have a talk. And I reckon we could talk for a lot longer. So probably get you back in another couple of years and a couple more books under your belt.
Hopefully I might run into you guys at a convention or a festival.
Yes, or you run into Tony Iommi, send him our way. You know, it's all good.
Well, I go to Birmingham so often now because that group are so keen on my work that, you know, it's highly likely I will run into him again because he's part of that crowd, you know.
Yeah.
Not really amusing, but thoroughly nice guys. That Steel Pulse turned up. Do you remember Steel Pulse, who were the sort of reggae band of the 70s? They were.
Okay.
They're all native Brummies, you know, and they read the books as well, which is fascinating, you know. Brilliant. So it's a universal appeal.
Amazing. Well, excellent. On that note, everybody go and check out Paul Finch's books.
Oh, yeah.
And P.W. Finch for the USURPER and Wolfbury Chronicles.
Yeah.
And best of luck for all the books and for the future.
Okay, yeah, well, thank you very much. Thanks for having me. I really appreciate being asked.
Thanks, Paul.
Excellent. Cheers, Paul.
That's it for today's episode. We hope you've enjoyed it. If you have, please take a moment to leave a review on whatever platform you're listening on. And don't forget to subscribe.
Let us know if you have any questions or things you would like us to cover in future episodes. We're on Facebook, facebook.com/rockpaperswordspodcast, and X at @rock_swords. You can find out more about our books on matthewhaffey.com and stephenamackay.com. Come on!
Oh, sorry. The theme music is written and performed and copyrighted by us. Until next time on Rock, Paper, Swords, it's goodbye from me, Matthew Harvey.
And it's goodbye from me, Stephen A. Mackay.
And remember, whatever action and adventure you have going on in your life, be kind.
Stay safe.
And happy reading. I can hear you.